Amazingly, the second episode of the OOTPC, it's actually happening again. It's happening again.
Yes, sorry, it is happening again.
It's Twin Peaks reference, I had to put that in there. Anyway, maybe we'll talk about that in a future episode of the podcast. But right now, we've got a few topics lined up for you guys. It's going to be great. We've planned. We've discussed what we're going to discuss. It's not going to be random. Well, it's probably still going to be random.
It's going to be random.
There's going to be some semblance of order, so, because we are in the order of tier. All right, so, again, welcome. We're order of tier. That guy over there, one of these sides, however we do this thing.
That guy is,
who knows. It'll probably be different this time, but
probably.
That guy is Mike the Hammer K. Klitzinski. How are you doing, Mike?
Bro, I am super duper. How are you doing, Jabatuya?
I'm extra super duper. I'm dupity duper.
Oh,
that was stupid.
Holy
anyway, I am Jordan B. Sanders, and I'm doing pretty decently as well, my friends out there over the internets. First plugs: videogamemetal.com, twitter.com/orderoftier, facebook.com/orderoftier, youtube.com/orderoftier, all the things/orderoftier except for SoundCloud, which is /videogamemetal. We'll say that again at the end, but now, for the main event, the topics at hand for the podcast.
Yes.
I think we'll go ahead and we'll start with some band news again. How about that, Michael?
I think that's fantastic.
All right. Would you like to lead for us?
Sure. So, nothing new on a new album front, but we're going to be doing some covers here shortly.
Yes.
So that's pretty exciting. We have a few covers lined up that we have. Well, we have a list of things to do, basically. but our first endeavor is going to be covering the True Survivor song, which is from the lovely movie Kung Fury. If you have yet to see that, you should definitely check that out because it will change your life.
Absolutely. Link below.
Yes, link below. Other than that, that's about all we got going on. More info to come on that soon. But
yeah, definitely we wanted to get that cover in while people still remembered what Kung Fury was.
Exactly. That.
But yeah, that's got me pretty excited. Of course, I'm like, both of us, we're like ultra 80s nerds. And like, for me, it's like, I don't know. If I could live in the 80s, but like have the internet, I think I would.
Exactly. That movie. But yeah,
dude, it's nuts. Maybe we should take some time in a future podcast to talk about that, because
noted,
that's some next level stuff.
Yes,
but so that's the band news. Definitely some other interesting things potentially going on. Some rumblings in the works. So those rumblings. Yeah, some epic rumblings. But yes. As those things develop, we will definitely keep you guys informed of what's going on there. So look forward to that. All right, before we get into like our real big topics for today, I wanted to go back and do a correction from last time's podcast. So, I don't know if you guys are like I am, but whenever I see, you know, like some guy or a set of guys on YouTube doing videos talking about stuff or listening to a podcast, hearing them talk about stuff, and they say something that's just like, I know right off the bat's wrong, I'm like, oh, I just like cringe just immediately. And I did that last week, I think, for like two different things, at least two that I remember after the fact. One, and I have to go back and correct myself because I'm just like completely crazy like that. So you can ask Mike, he can attest to how perfectionist I can be.
we both are. Honestly, we should probably just have a segment at the beginning of every podcast where we correct stuff we said in the previous podcast.
That could get dangerous, though, because it could be like a whole podcast. Be like, yeah, that last one, just forget it. It was all wrong.
Right. And then we do the same podcast every single time.
That's right. That's all it is.
Yeah.
But we're iterating. We're getting better, right?
Yeah,
eventually, sure. it'll be perfect. But, so last time, two things that, they're both regarding Mortal Kombat. One was ridiculous that I was talking about, you know, the games in order, and I know I got that wrong too, but I'm not worried so much about that because I didn't really play all of them in order, so whatever. But the thing that really, like when I was actually listening back to the podcast and I heard it, I was like, oh, that's not right, was that I was talking about the Mortal Kombat after Deception that has like all the characters in it, and I called it Annihilation, and like, oh no, that's like the second Mortal Kombat movie that was like really bad, but they just tried to name drop everybody.
I didn't even realize that.
Yeah. Okay. So that game's actually called Mortal Kombat Armageddon. So for all of you super huge Mortal Kombat fans out there that, you know, had that wince moment when I said that, there you go. But the other thing I think was probably less of a, oh my goodness, than that one, which was, I said that the Mortal Kombat on N64 was Mortal Kombat Gold, but the one on N64 was Mortal Kombat Trilogy. Mortal Kombat Gold was on the Dreamcast. So,
okay.
I knew that kind of sounded wrong too, but I didn't realize it until later. I actually looked that up because I wasn't absolutely certain that it was wrong, and turns out it was, so I should have known.
Was Gold a 3D game, or was that a 2D game?
No, I think this is why I probably got it confused. I think that Gold was, the content wasn't exactly the same, but it was kind of like Trilogy for Dreamcast. So it was like Ultimate Mortal Kombat 3 plus more characters, plus more stages, that sort of thing.
Okay, gotcha.
So, like, Ultimate Mortal Kombat 3.
I asked because I don't even remember there being a Mortal Kombat for Dreamcast. So.
Yeah. I only remember the name because I would see it in Best Buy when I would go and look at video games and stuff. I never had a Dreamcast when it was, like, you know, in production. So,
it was, I don't even know why it stuck with me. A year and a half, so...
True. Well, let me put it this way. When I got my Dreamcast, I paid like $20 for it and like 3 games, so...
Bro, that's the deal of the century right there.
Oh, I know, right? It was... Yeah, well, it was... I don't have it anymore, so that's sad. But,
that's very unfortunate.
That's neither here nor there.
That bro is loud, though. I never realized how loud it was. I prayed to it recently. I played it recently. And it's like checking disc. It's like, wow.
Yeah, I think that when they created the Xbox 360, they actually were trying to throw back to the Dreamcast.
Right. Exactly.
It sounds like it's going to take off like a jet engine.
Oh, man. We should just have a segment where we talk about console sounds.
Oh, man. I could do it. We should make a whole song.
This is random. They release 3DS themes. And I don't remember when it came out, a few months back, but they released a Dreamcast 3DS theme, and they actually recorded, like, had microphones miking a Dreamcast and recorded like all the sounds that it makes while it's operating.
Oh man, like even the disc spinning and all that.
Yeah.
Oh man.
I think it was only in Japan though.
Oh, naturally. Yeah. Naturally. Man, oh, that's crazy. That also reminded me that somewhere, on YouTube, like, and there isn't, it's not just one. If you go and search this, there's, like, dozens of videos that are, like, you know, everybody does, like, top tens or whatever. It's like, but this one's, like, top 10 video game console openings or whatever. And it's, like, and it, like, counts down, like, you know. Of course, almost all of them have GameCube as number one because, like, the little G going around in the sounds. And then all of the alternate ones that it has. But I thought that was... I watched them. So I'm not going to lie. I watched them. But I thought that was pretty funny that somebody... Not somebody, several people, you know, made videos of that. And, of course, you know, the original PlayStation was, like, super epic.
Yeah. What's your favorite game or console opening?
Oh, man. I mean, it has to be the original PlayStation. Mainly because one of the first games I ever played... was it one? Yeah, I think it was the first game, full game, I played on the PlayStation. Like, no, that's not true, the second. So when I got a PlayStation, I had the demo disc, you know, that came with it and whatnot. And then I had Parappa the Rappa, which is... I love that game. Oh, my goodness, I love that game. But the first game, aside from Parappa the Rappa that I played, I rented Resident Evil 2. Mm. And this is why Resident Evil 2 has such a huge place in my heart. But, like, to me, I played Resident... And then I subsequently, very soon thereafter, bought Resident Evil 2. I played that game so much that, like, the sound of the system startup is inseparable from that game for me. So it's like thinking about that, it's like I think about one and I think about the other. So it's got to be the original PlayStation.
Yeah.
What about you, sir?
Well, yeah. I'm just going to have to go with Saturn just because.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah.
I probably put more hours into games on that, just, you know, turning it off and on, than anything else. So, yeah, it's just nostalgic for me.
So, no Sega CD opening?
I know this. There's so many good openings, that's the thing.
Yeah, yeah.
The Sega CD opening isn't very nostalgic for me, because, actually, I really like the Sega CD now. This is weird going way off topic here. I really like the Sega CD now, but when I first got it, I actually got it, and I got Sonic CD, of course, and it just pissed me off because it loaded so slowly, because, you know, I was yeah. from cartridge land at the time, so I didn't know what CD load times were, and, you know, this thing has, like, a blazing 1x CD-ROM drive or something like
0.5x.
that. Yeah, so, I and then stupidest decision ever, I actually got my mom to return it the next day, and she got me a 32X.
Oh, man.
worst thing ever. Yeah. So eventually I did actually get a Sega CD, and I got, you know, quite a few games for it that I missed out on. And
yeah.
It's pretty cool.
Man.
But yeah, that's... I have a few a list of things in my my gaming history that I'm very proud of, and that is one of them. So yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So now we know why people have these top 10, you know, console opening exactly. videos out on YouTube. All right, so that's that. Anything else before we move on, Mr. Hammer K?
Negatory.
All right, so we have two more topics. Including a special reoccurring segment that we're going to be doing from now on. We'll talk about that in a little bit. But before that, we actually almost started talking about this last time when we were having our discussion about Allison Road and, you know, Punity and their relation to PT. We almost broached the topic of Gone Home, which is a game that I've been meaning to play forever. I've owned forever. Michael has played it how long ago now?
I think it was last summer. So, like, maybe a little over a year ago, something like that.
Yeah, yeah. So, and ever since he played it, he's been on me to play it. And I've been meaning to, and you know how life goes. Right. But I finally did, and I finished it, I don't know, maybe 3-4 weeks ago now, something like that, and so we figured we'd take some time to talk about the game because, spoilers, I enjoyed it.
Yeah.
And a lot of people do, if you look at their reviews and whatnot. So Michael, I'll let you lead here since you kind of led me into the game.
Right.
Let us speak about Gone Home.
We're going to have to tag team this because I don't remember a lot of the details. I just remember my general experience playing the game. So, the reason why the topic of this game came up last time with all PT and all those other games is because it's one of those games that you start off and you don't know anything. And you're in this world, you don't know why, you don't know who you are, why you're looking at this house, why there's nobody in this house. And it's extremely open-ended, and it's kind of one of those games where your experience differs depending on your personality, I guess. Just the way that you interpret your surroundings and all that kind of stuff. For me, that was the coolest aspect of the game. It was the first game that I had played like that, where, you know, you feel helpless the whole time. There are no weapons or anything. And you know, I'm not gonna lie, the entire time I was terrified. I thought there was gonna be like some freaking tarantula, six-headed monster Medusa that was gonna kill me at any point.
Before we go any further, spoilers for Gone Home, yes, potentially.
Before you listen to this slash watch it, you need to experience this game, because if you have any of this spoiled, it is spoiled, and
yeah,
that's that.
I mean, it would still be a good game to play, but the impact would be lost.
Yeah. Yes, that. So anyway, begin spoilers. So I was terrified the entire time I was playing this game. Like,
yes.
That, imagine, you know, walking into a mansion and, you know, there's stuff. It looks like someone, a family had been living here, but they are all gone. And you have no idea why they're gone. And, oh, by the way, there's a thunderstorm. Because reasons, of course, why not? And everything that you do is extremely, extremely creepy. And you start picking things up and you see things like, you know, ghost stuff, like ghost books and whatever. It's like, I'm going to die here tonight.
Yeah, like literally the whole game, I thought there were going to be jump scares. Yep. And I kept asking Michael, there's no jump scares in this game, are there? He's like, oh, no. I'm like, I think he's lying to me, because right. I really thought you were, because I thought I was going to get got in it, but...
Yep.
Again, spoilers, there are no jump scares, so... Unless I missed them. Well, I guess there's one that could be construed as a jump scare, but not really. Like, when you find that one secret passage with the light in it, you have to turn on the light, and then, like, if you... There's like a cross or something. Like if you look at it, then the light pops out.
Oh, right, yeah.
Yeah, but I mean, it's not like a real jump scare or anything. Mm-hmm. So this thing, I guess that's and then like the thunder, right? Because that happens randomly and it's pretty loud when it happens.
Right.
And I play with headphones on, so you know the immersion.
Oh man, and whatnot. I didn't do that. That's cool. So what was it about? So you're this girl, and was she studying abroad, or was she? What was she doing?
So I got confused until the very, very end. I thought that... So you play as Katie, and she, like you said, she's been studying abroad for a year, and then she comes back home, and nobody's home, and she's just trying to, you know, see what's going on.
Yeah.
But the premise of the game is that you're constructing information about your sister's life.
Yes.
Especially, like, while you were gone. And see, I thought you were playing as the sister the whole time. Until the very end, and then we'll get to the end. But, you know, and you see the end, and I'm like, oh, okay, no, I'm Katie. And so that made it lose a little bit of impact for me, so that kind of sucked. But, yeah, so you're playing as Katie. She's come back home. She's seeing a lot of information about her, I'm assuming, younger sisters. And I'm sure it's explicit in the game, but I'm from context
clues. Yeah, I think it was.
Yeah, her younger sister's life while Katie was abroad. And her, you know, struggle with adapting to a new school, struggle with making friends and things like that. And that's the crux of the game, right? Is, what is... I wish I could remember her sister's name, but it's Katie. The crux of the story of the game, if there's any plot you want to call it, it's not really a plot, but the unfolding of the game is understanding the relationships that Katie's sister makes in school, and her, you know, learning more about herself and how to, you know, live in the way society is, and trying to adapt and, you know, be a kid in the 90s when, you know, things were getting better socially, but still, you know, there's a lot of weird stuff. I mean, even now there's still weird stuff, but especially back then, there's a lot of, you know, real crazy bullying and all that, because, you know, we've all been through that to a degree, I would expect. I mean, I know I did, because I was overweight and still am, and so, you know, that you kind of... identify with the character that way. Yeah. Anyway, I'm getting a little too deep without trying to be too specific. I don't know how specific we want to be here, but you could talk for a little while. I talked for a lot right there.
What do I want to talk about?
Yeah.
That is a good question.
There is Twin Peaks reference in the game.
Really?
So. Oh, yeah.
I'm not going to lie. I still like to watch that show.
Yeah, you do.
That's on my list of things to do.
It's on the locker, like, you know, the locker that's locked in the bedroom. You know, you have all those cutouts and pasted on there. Yeah. It's two of the characters from Twin Peaks, and okay. It's Laura Palmer and Donna Hayward. And Laura Palmer is in the series the girl who gets killed. You find out in the beginning of the first episode. That's kind of what the show's about, kind of. And so it's like a picture of her, and she's like, "You better not be going reading my secret diary." And then that Donna, and she has got like a speech bubble above her, and she's like, dot dot dot.
Oh, I remember.
Yeah.
That.
So. Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, that's cool.
Man. Oh, this game takes place in 1995, I think.
Oh, I don't remember that.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. That's the whole thing. That's why it's significant. There's a lot of, like, period things, right? The Super Nintendo, mm-hmm. Street Fighter 2 on the Super Nintendo. Punk making its way more toward mainstream. And so, yeah. Like, people who aren't, like, way into scene stuff coming in contact with punk music.
Man, I forgot about all that. This game's deep.
Oh, it's super. It's, like, completely rich. Like, everything is so detailed. You know, obviously you find, like, cassette tapes everywhere, yeah. And, like, conveniently there's always a cassette player near where all the tapes are, but that's pretty cool to hear it. And, like, the music, are we just going to talk about this whole thing? Because, like, I feel like I'm restraining myself.
Blow it.
All right.
We already said spoilers.
Yeah, super spoilers for yes. Gone Home. The whole crux of the story in Gone Home is that Katie's sister is realizing she's a lesbian and falling in love with this other girl, like really falling in love. Like, I mean, it's very detailed about like her being weirded out about having feelings or expressing feelings about a girl. And then you find out later that she actually knew she was a lesbian for a while, through some of the notes that you read. And, about her, you know, adapting to that in a society that's, you know, pretty hostile to it. I mean, even today, to a degree, depending on where you are, you know, society can be very hostile toward, you know, people who are homosexual. I mean, it's a fact of life, but, you know, people just are afraid, and they act out their fear through hate and, you know, malice and violence, and it's just stupid. But you get this kind of front row seat of the other side, right? You know, being on the outside of that, it's hard to understand. You know, I feel like I sympathize with people going through that kind of a struggle, because I've had similar struggles, but it's not really the same, right? There's no, like, there's never been, like, this real negative, like, super negative societal look on overweight people. I mean, yeah, okay, people make fun of overweight people and blah, 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 whatever, but it's not like, oh, yeah, this thing that's inherent to who you are, yeah, that's bad, and you're wrong because of that, you know? It's like, I feel like I could probably change myself and lose weight, but you're not gonna, like, go to the gym and not be homosexual, right? So, it's like this, it's just, I don't know, it's something that was so visceral about reading it from her point of view, and about her falling in love, and it just makes that whole thing real. And I could see somebody who's, like, not necessarily supportive of the idea of homosexual behavior, or whatever you want to call it, or however they would want to call it, playing this game and questioning that, right? You know, really thinking, oh man, this was like a pretty deep love story to a degree about the other side. Yeah. So to speak. I mean, I'm trying to be careful with the words that I say, because I definitely don't want to offend anybody at all. Because I understand that's a real struggle for people, even to today, right? Mm-hmm. So, and then the story goes on that her girlfriend decides to, you know, join the military, because, like, she was from a military family, and is leaving, and then, you know, everybody's trying to get her to not be homosexual, and say, no, it's just a phase, and she makes a really good point. I think the most poignant moment in the game is where she, you know, says that she wished her parents had been mad when she came out to them, had been angry and yelled at her, instead of just saying, oh, it's a phase, you'll grow out of it. Because it's like undermining her humanity and her understanding of herself. And it's like, I mean, I'm not going to lie, I kind of teared up at that point. It's a very emotional game, and I might tear up now if I'm not careful. But it was just extremely emotional. Anyway, it goes on. Her girlfriend is going to the army, and she's just struggling with being alone and not liking it, and ends up, then she runs away to be with her girlfriend. Supposedly, or the way that I saw it, without her parents' either knowledge or consent, because she knew it was the right thing to do. And I mean, you know, that's one of those things, man. You when you feel stuff like that, it's your life. You gotta act how you want and need for your life. You gotta seize those things that are important. I mean, maybe it's fleeting, and I don't mean, you know, her being a lesbian's fleeting, but maybe that relationship's fleeting, but I think you're always going to have bigger regrets about not doing something than you are about doing something. There's actually a quotation that I had on my Facebook for a long time, and I can't for the life of me remember now who did it. It was some writer, but he said something like, and I'm certainly paraphrasing, but like, the regret for things done can be tempered by time, but the regret for things undone is inconsolable.
Woo!
So I think that kind of sums up, you know, kind of her action at the end of the game. Like, yeah. It was a very happy ending, I think. I felt uplifted by it, so.
Yeah, I was pleasantly surprised. I was like, I didn't die. This was not, this was not a horror game.
Yeah. It was completely non-combat gaming, as we were talking about last week. It was like, no violence. No violence perpetrated in the game, anyway.
Yeah. And that's really cool hearing your experience playing the game, because it just throws that out there. You know, it's very open-ended as to how you experience the game. I mean, I've read online that you can pretty much just run through this game in like 15 or 20 minutes.
Oh, yeah.
If you just fly through it, if you know what to do. So you can do that. You can just do that, or, you know, you can pull different things from it and have your own experience. It's just kind of however you experience it. So that's really cool.
Yeah, this is definitely one of those games where, you know, whether it's trying to be or not, it's an art game, right?
Yeah.
And I think it completely succeeded in that goal. In being an art game, again, whether it was a goal or not. I would have a hard time believing it wasn't a goal for the developers. Mm-hmm. But it's one of those things where, like you're saying, you could speedrun it, but you're not playing the game at that point. You're just, you're flipping a lot of virtual switches on and off inside of a program. That's what gaming is to a degree, always, especially in speedrunning. But if you don't really try to explore this game, you're doing yourself a disservice. I mean, you're honestly kind of wasting your time to a bit, because the whole point, I think, of this game is really to maximize your time in this experience before you get to the end.
Mm-hmm.
I did that out of habit, not really out of knowing that was the case, because, like, whenever I play sort of, you know, adventure-y games like this where you have to find items to do things and all that, I'm like, okay, where are all the interactive objects? Let me interact with all the interactive objects. And so, like, I feel very confident that I opened every drawer in that game. and let me tell you, if you have not played that game, there are a lot of drawers in this game.
Yes, there are.
A lot of empty drawers, too. I mean, it's realistic. It's in that sense.
Lots of, what the frig is this? What do I do with this? I can't do anything with this.
Yeah. Oh, I can turn it over! Oh, it's blank on the back. But the details are just great. I mean, like, you can pick up, like, Super Nintendo cartridges and like turn them around. And it's like, you know, oh yeah, they obviously spent a lot of time designing, you know, the model for the cartridge because it looks like a Super Nintendo cartridge, you know, stuff like that. It's just pretty cool. I have to say, and this isn't an opinion, I did not like the music from the band, her girlfriend's band, but I appreciate the aesthetic because it was very true to that whole, you know, garage punk sound, like just, you know, put a mic in the middle of the room, hear the squealing amps and clanging drums, but man, that was hard to listen to.
Put a tape recorder in the middle of the room and put a pillow over it or something.
Yep. I mean, that it sounded just like that. So I certainly appreciated that nostalgia and that, you know, aspect of realism in it. But I really liked the game. I think when I got it, I paid like a couple bucks for it. Definitely no more than five. And I feel bad. I feel really bad. I wish I had bought this game at like full price. Like, because it's one of those games that's worth paying the developers who put the time and energy to make a game like this.
Yeah, no doubt. I think I got it on, it was like $7 when I got it.
Yeah. Oh, man.
But worth every penny. I would have paid more for it. Oh, yeah.
I, just even now thinking and talking about the game, I just feel like very moved emotionally. It's a very moving game. I've not been that deeply moved by a game in a very long time. Gone Home, that's a great game.
Yeah. If you haven't played it, well, you shouldn't be listening to this right now. But, that's right.
Go bleach your brain and go play it without knowledge of what we just said.
Or we can flashy thing you.
Oh, yeah. I don't have a flashy thing. We'll pretend you remember none of this. So. Okay. Awesome. Oh, yeah, there you go. Cool. So anything else that you want to say about Gone Home before we move on, Michael?
Negative.
Awesome. Go play that game. Yes. All right. So, moving on. I guess we're going to do this every podcast. I don't know. What do you think, Michael?
Yeah, I think it's a good idea. Have kind of a reoccurring segment here.
I think when we do this in the video, we have to put like titles on the screen to show this because it's not going to make as much sense if we don't.
Exactly.
But so we're having a reoccurring segment about, you know, the top whatever for us. So we'll pick a category and then we'll talk about the top several games or movies or whatever we want to pick to us in that category and talk a little bit about them. And we're going to call that segment Top Tier. And so it sounds like I'm just saying T-I-E-R, but like T-Y-R, order of tier. Get it?
LOL. That's us or something.
So here, like Top Tier. Hopefully it's here right now, or it was recently, and I'm doing that awkward thing where the title happened before, but I'm pointing to it actually after it's off the screen.
Yes, that.
So, Mr. Hammer K, what is today's top tier topic?
The topic for the day is Zelda games.
Oh, man. Let's start with a bang.
Yeah, so this is any Zelda game. If you want to do NES or CDI or GameCube or whatever.
CDI. Well, excuse me, princess. Oh, man. All right, so I didn't know if we wanted to do like a top three or something or just talk about our favorite ones or how do you want to do this, brother? This is called professionalism when we didn't decide what we're going to do before we do it.
Exactly. I figure we could just go back and forth or something.
All right, man. You first, because I said so.
Man. Okay. So let's see. So this game came out last year, I think. Or maybe it was the year before. I don't remember.
I'm going to have... I have no idea about current Zelda games, recent Zelda games, so...
This game was called Link Between Worlds. Okay. And it was actually set in the same universe as it's Link, Link to the Past. It's kind of continuing that era, that story that's happening there.
Right.
And it brings back that whole top head view, which is cool. Something that I really like in Zelda games is I really like it when, not necessarily when it looks really realistic, like Twilight Princess, but I like it when all the enemies and stuff look like gummy candies that I can eat. when everything looks cute and cuddly, even when it's an evil beast. That's my kind of Zelda game. The cool thing about this game is that, you know, every Zelda game has its mechanic, whatever. This game has this kind of drawing mechanic where you go flat, like 2D, on a wall.
Oh, yeah.
And then slide around the wall. And it's just the way that this game uses that mechanic, it just opens up so many different possibilities for puzzles that, you know, hadn't been done before.
So,
and it's cool, you know, revisiting a lot of the stuff that in Link to the Past, kind of, you know, redoing that, re-experiencing some of that stuff, so that's cool. So, yeah.
That sounds pretty sweet, man. So is that on Wii U, or just...
It is on 3DS. I didn't even say that. Yeah. It's on, it's on 3DS.
Awesome.
I got a sweet... gold 3DS that it's gold on the top and black on the bottom. It has Triforce on both sides.
Oh, that's cute.
Yeah. So yeah.
Man, I don't have a 3DS. That's sad.
I would highly recommend this thing. There's so many great games for it, as is the case with so many other things.
But I also want a Wii U and a PS4. So.
Yeah. Just buy all three. Problem solved.
Oh, if it were that easy. Oh man. Yes, all of my problems literally would be solved.
Yes, that's exactly right. I'm so glad you realized this.
If I had bought a PS4 this time last year, all of my problems would have been solved.
That's
for sure. Mm-hmm. Oh my goodness.
Which, speaking of this, random side note, I read an article online about how to put PT on a flash drive so I can back it up, which I need to do this. I'm literally going to buy a flash drive specifically for this purpose.
And put it in, like, a lockbox.
Yes.
Like a fireproof lockbox.
Yes.
Inside of a gold case.
That. Yes.
Man.
Ugh. Anyway, you're it.
All right, so I got three that I wanted to talk about if we have time. But if not, that's okay, too. So the first one I wanted to talk about is actually the only one of those three that I've not completed, and I've been meaning to forever, and obviously I haven't, but I've played enough to know that I know that it is definitely one of my favorite Zelda games of all time, and that is Wind Waker. Mm. And I think one of the reasons that I like this game so much is that when the Wii came out, and you know, when they first started talking about, oh yeah, Zelda on the Wii... Wind Waker was after Twilight Princess, right? No. Yes, Wind Waker's on GameCube. Jeez, yeah, what am I say this because I played it. I played it on Wii, not on GameCube. Mm. But yes. So the GameCube Zelda, excuse me. And when they started talking about that, you know, then they started showing screenshots. I was like, what the crap? Just like everybody was, right? Everybody was like, what the heck? This does not look like a Zelda game, and you know, it looks like a cartoon.
Right.
Why would I want to play it? Everybody looks like children. Exactly. Why would I want to play this game? But then you play it, and then you're like, holy crap, this game is so epic. It is, I mean, the art style just completely adds to it. You know, I thought that, you know, I was going to have to get over it and just like, okay, I'm just going to deal with it. But no, it makes it feel unique and just fun. I mean, just the art style gives it more fun than it would be if it were just like, you know, Majora's Mask 2 or, well, Ocarina of Time 3 or whatever, right? I think it was absolutely the right decision to make it that way. And then the story's really cool, too. Like, again, I haven't beaten it, but I've gotten far enough to see the arc of the story, or at least a good bit of the arc of the story. And that's why I want to finish it, because I know it's going to be really sweet if I do. But yeah, like the sailing and all of that, that was just really cool. Oh, man. It really felt like you're exploring again, you know? That was one of the things that I loved about Ocarina of Time, right? Is that with the 3D world like that, it really felt like you were exploring. And then it's like, well, how do you make a game that still feels like you're exploring, but feels like you're doing even more than just, you know, running around like in Ocarina of Time? And the sailing, you know, I don't know what real popular opinion is on this particular Zelda game, but to me, it made it really feel like the world was huge compared to, like, Ocarina of Time. I mean, Ocarina of Time felt really big, but, you know, once you understood where everything was, it was like, oh, it's not that big. But Wind Waker feels really big, at least to me. Anyway, so, yeah, I love Wind Waker.
Yeah, that is a beautiful game. And I haven't beaten it either, actually. It's on my list.
Maybe we should play through it together.
Yeah, that'd be cool.
Oh, yeah. Man, if we should play through it together, we should, like, you know, make a video of it. We got to figure out how to do that.
We do.
Like, that would be awesome, because that would be a way for me to actually finish some games.
Yes. Both of us actually experience games, and we can talk about them.
Amazing. So, yeah, Wind Waker. That's a thing.
Yeah. Am I tagged? Is it my turn?
Yeah, I think you're tagged. Tapping?
Okay. So, I'm just going to go ahead and say I have three that I'm planning on talking about. So my second one, this is going to sound weird, but this is actually the first Zelda game that I played all the way through after Ocarina of Time, and this is Link's Awakening.
For
Game Boy. I actually played the Game Boy Color version. I think there was like one extra dungeon or something in there.
Oh, okay.
I don't really remember what the deal was. But yeah, this game, I don't know, for me it's just really nostalgic, just because I put a lot of time into it because it was, you know, a mobile game. So I played it on the go all the time. Took it to school, played it probably when I shouldn't have been playing it. you know, all that kind of stuff. And the music is really awesome in this game. I have a list of songs on that we need to cover, or that we need to use as inspiration. Sweet. Or whatever.
Awesome.
So that definitely needs to happen. But yeah, it was really cool to me because it was and I know that, you know, like some of the older Zelda games, you know, you only have two buttons to really work with, but this was the first game that I really played all the way through where you only had two buttons to work with. And just the way that works is just awesome. How, you know, I went from playing Ocarina of Time where you have a million buttons to do all this stuff to, you know, have two and still able to accomplish that same kind of thing. But yeah, and I think the reason why I didn't really play as much of the ones prior to Ocarina of Time was just because those kind of games honestly didn't really interest me. What? I know. I was more into, like,
go fast!
Right, exactly. I was more into, like, platformer games and, you know, and stuff like that and whatever.
Hey, well, like, Zelda 2 is, like, a platformer.
That's very true. That's very
kind
true.
Kind of.
I don't know. At that point in my life, so, for those of you
that
who don't know.
That game's hard as balls, dude.
Yes, it is.
Goodness.
For those of you who don't know, my parents owned a video rental store in the 80s and early 90s. So I had video games flying out of my butt cheeks. And so I was playing a million different games. It was rare that I actually sat down and played one game all the way through. Of course, you know, some of my favorite ones I did, of course, or the ones that I owned. But if I was playing games that I got to rent from the store, you know, I'd play them, next, play them, next, play them, next. So, unfortunately, Zelda was kind of one of those games. And then, you know, going back and playing them, I had to do that eventually. But yeah. So, yeah. That's this episode should just be a list of things that I'm not proud of with my gaming career.
Oh man, that's funny.
Yep.
So side note or sidebar question. Please tell me you've completed the original Zelda game.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
I was gonna. I don't know what I was gonna do if the answer to that was no, but I'm glad to hear that it's yes.
I have not beaten the second one.
Oh, I haven't either. Yeah, I've tried many times, and I don't have the patience now, unfortunately. I might have when I was younger. I just didn't have the game when I was younger.
Right.
Because I played the mess out of the original one, dude. Oh my goodness. I rented it like I don't know how many times, and then finally I bought it when I got it like $10 at Walmart. And but this was when you could still buy NES games at Walmart.
Yeah.
And then that's when I finally beat it. Is when I owned it. Similar to your story.
Yep.
But man, oh man, that was good times when I finally beat the first one.
Great oldies.
Yeah. All right. So is that it for you on number two?
Yep.
Okay, well, we've talked about my number two already at least half a dozen times, but number two's Ocarina of Time. I say that, and then everybody's going to be able to guess what my first one is, but I love Ocarina of Time. I mean, what else are you going to say about that game? Like, anybody who says they don't like that game, I just don't understand it. It's like...
Agreed.
It is video games, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. It's like, it's not too cutesy, it's not too dark, it's not too violent, in my opinion, it's not too violent, it's not, you know, it's not too hard, it's not too easy, I mean, it can be argued it's kind of easy, but there's enough variety in, you know, exploration and just things going on in the game, that even if it is maybe a little easy, it's not, you know, it's okay, because yeah. It's just... such a great game. I don't even know how to speak about Ocarina of Time.
There are no words.
Yeah, it's like if you like kids today, but the younger generation's coming into video gaming later. I mean, I'm glad that kids are still interested in video games. I'm glad it's a big thing. I'm glad the industry is, you know, seemingly doing well. Mm-hmm. You know, on the whole, anyway. And I'm glad that, you know, we're getting the advancement that we are in the field. But I love that, you know, some younger kids who, you know, were born after Ocarina of Time came out are playing it and are enjoying it. Mm-hmm. But you can't understand what it was like to play a 3D Zelda game for the first time.
Oh, yeah.
After years and years of, you know, the original Zelda, Zelda 2, Link to the Past. It's like, those games are amazing games. Like, even two, you know, people argue, oh, that game sucks. No, it's just different. It doesn't suck. It's hard as crap, but it's different, but it doesn't suck. It's a good game. Again, IMO. I'll always IMO when I'm speaking, but playing, like, the first time when you get out into Hyrule Field in Ocarina of Time, it is just like, I was just, like, transfixed, you know, just, like, staring at the screen, like, oh, my goodness. And then the sun sets, and it's nighttime. Uh-huh. It's like, what? What the heck? What kind of games do this? And, you know, that kind of stuff is, like, people take that super for granted these days, and it's, like, oh, yeah. Everywhere. But that was a big thing back then.
Yep.
Oh, man. This,
no doubt.
You can't speak words to really explain it to somebody who wasn't able to experience it. And I'm sorry, younger people, I'm not going to say, I feel like kids may be a demeaning term, and I never mean it that way when I say it, but you younger people who didn't have the benefit of growing up and experiencing that transition of Legend of Zelda from 2D to 3D, it was a very special thing.
Yes, it was.
And I wish you could have experienced it. That's all I'm going to say about that. Mm-hmm. So, tag!
Yeah. You know, I've heard that a lot of people, side note, some people don't really just they don't really connect with 3D Zelda games. Not that they don't like them, but that they just, that play style of that kind of game just doesn't jive with them for some reason.
Yeah, I can see that, and it's understandable. I mean, yeah. Some people, all they want to play is first-person shooters, and that's fine.
This is true.
Nothing wrong with that. I understand not enjoying a certain, genre of game and feeling like the 2D to 3D transition brought it into a different genre, because, I mean, it kind of did. It ramped up the adventure aspect of it, I think.
Mm-hmm.
In my opinion, it did.
Yeah.
And that's why I liked it so much, because I love adventure games. Like, I really do. So, yeah.
Yeah.
But yeah, point well taken for sure.
Yeah. So, my top one, I just decided recently, actually.
No.
Yeah. And this is extremely controversial, what I'm about to say here. So,
if you say Twilight Princess, I'm gonna slap you.
No way. I don't think I could sit down and play that game again if I wanted to. That was one of those games where I had to really force myself to beat it.
Oh, I didn't beat it.
It started off, I was like, yeah, this is great. This is great. Yeah.
Oh, carpal tunnel sets in.
Oh man, I'm so glad motion controls have died.
Yeah.
I mean,
there's a time and place, but a Zelda game is not that time and place.
Yeah, or like the blowing into the controller thing to duck or whatever.
Oh jeez.
I don't even know. I think that was that Donkey Kong game. You had to blow into the controller to do something. I don't remember. Anyway.
Although, I have to say, the speaker in the controller is a really sweet thing.
Yes, it is. Most definitely. It's especially cool when it's like an audio transmission or something. It's like, oh, I can hear it.
Yeah.
Or
like friggin' Silent Hill Shattered Memories. Anyway, that's a completely different episode, too.
Yes.
We're
revealing future topics.
Hey, have you... Sorry. This is totally inappropriate time for me to ask you this question.
Yes, hit me.
But did you ever play Shattered Memories?
I have it like next on my list. Like, I'm not even joking. I have a list, and it's next on my list.
Okay, you have to play that before we talk about it. But go.
Yes. Anyway, rewinding.
Back to Zelda.
I love Ocarina of Time. Ocarina of Time, and the reason why I didn't talk about Ocarina of Time is because. I figured one of us was going to talk about it, so I didn't even want to bring it up. But I love Ocarina of Time. But I just played Majora's Mask recently. Like, I had played it before. I played it in the past. I had it when it first came out. And, it's different. And it's pretty weird if you're, you just came out of Ocarina of Time. You're like, all right, let's do Ocarina of Time 2! And then it's... Yeah. Not quite that. It's way, way different. But I got it for the 3DS. It just came out, like a remake, a few months back. Mm-hmm. And finally beat it for the first time. And playing this game, knowing what to expect, I enjoyed it way, 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 way more than I ever did previously when I just, got it and was just like, okay... The moon is killing me now, and the game's over. What? And all that stuff. But I don't know. It was just something about that sense of urgency that you get in that game, almost kind of like an adrenaline rush or something that, and how you're constantly having to travel back and forwards in time and all this stuff to make these things happen. And some of the one of the masks that you have to get, you have to do all these different things throughout the 3 days in order for it to happen. And just little details like that are just really cool. Yeah,
I have to be completely honest. I've played maybe 2 minutes of Majora's Mask in my entire life.
Yeah. I played it for a few hours, and... I got stuck, or I had to, there's this one part where you have to do something that if you don't have more than one jar, it literally takes forever. Okay. You have to go collect like these six Zora eggs and put them in these jars, and if you have a bunch of jars, you're golden, but if you only have one jar, then you have to go back and forth to this place six times. It's like you have to penetrate this fortress six times to get these. Yeah, so I had a much more enjoyable experience playing it this time around.
Note to self, if I ever play Majora's Mask, get a buttload of jars.
Yes, get all the jars. Yeah, it's just, it was really cool.
Sweet.
Yeah.
Awesome. Well, I probably should play it.
I would highly, especially if you, you know, when you get a 3DS, you should get it.
Subtle.
And the whole mask thing is really cool too, just the way you transform and you have all these different moves and stuff that you do. Depending on, you know, which mask you're wearing, and sometimes how you have to solve a puzzle, you have to switch between masks to, do that kind of thing. So, I really like the Zelda games that take some mechanic in that game and just go all out with that mechanic.
Mm-hmm.
Instead of, like, Twilight Princess, where I can't even really remember freaking anything about it except riding around as a dog or a wolf or whatever.
Oh, yeah, that's right. You're a wolf. Oh, man. Anyway. Okay, so my last one on my list, I'm sure everybody can guess by now, but it's A Link to the Past. Again, like Ocarina of Time, it's hard to really speak about why this was such a special game. Because I could pretty easily see, actually, younger folks coming to the game today, playing it and thinking, I mean, it's a good game, but why is everybody all crazy about it? But if you, so some of us played role-playing games when we were younger. Some of us did not. So if you were acquainted with role-playing games around the time of Ocarina of Time, it may not have made as big of an impact to you. For me, I played a few role-playing games, but I never got into them like I am now, right? You know, it's like, you know, I've played through Final Fantasy I, Final Fantasy II now, you know. So I've had that experience now, being older, and that was back when I was in college, but when I was younger, I didn't really have that experience. The only thing I remember of Final Fantasy I from back then was, man, this game is way too hard. This was not made for me, so I gave up on that one really easily. But Link to the Past was like one of the first games that like had a really long, relatively speaking, long plot and lots of places to explore, things to uncover, things to do, to get to the end of the game and to beat it. And it's just one of those games that by the time you get to the end of the game, you really feel like you've gone on a huge journey. You feel like, you know, you can do so much more now than when you started the game. And the way to prove it to yourself is, like, as soon as you beat the game, start the game over immediately and feel all the stuff that you don't have, all the things that are missing. And it's like, wow, it's a real sense of progression in the game. The first couple wasn't so much so like that, especially not the first one, because it was, I don't want to say it's short, but there's no real progression. There's just, okay, yeah, I have more hearts so I can stay alive longer, and I have more items so I can use them for things. But most of the items are only really important as sort of like key items, right? So,
yeah.
But Link to the Past was something else. I mean, you felt like you were growing, you were becoming more of a presence in that world.
Mm-hmm.
I loved it. In case you can't tell.
Right. Yeah. I love it when I play a Zelda game and by the end I feel like I have grown and created this hero and just, you know, like learned all this stuff and collected all this stuff, and that's how I felt when I beat Majora's Mask. That's how I felt when I beat all the games that I mentioned.
I think that's an excellent way to put it. At the end of A Link to the Past, I felt like I was a hero.
Yeah.
At the end of the first Zelda game, I didn't really feel like that. I felt like, oh, I beat the game.
Right, that.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's how I know I really enjoyed a Zelda game. Do I feel like I beat this, or do I feel like a hero?
Yeah, yeah. Ocarina of Time gives you that same feeling at the end, too, especially because, you know, all the items, like the different arrows and stuff you have to use to beat the game. It's good stuff, man. Zelda games are great when they take their time, they design them well, and they don't get gimmicky.
Yep, exactly. One of them that will remain unmentioned that we've actually talked about a few times. Not that it's a bad game, but did you know that Twilight Princess for GameCube is actually, it's about $65-$70 on eBay because...
Oh, really?
Because no it is the Wii version stripped of all the motion controls and all that junk, and it's just, you know, just the game.
That's crazy. That's so, absolutely crazy.
Another good one is Skyward Sword.
That's one I haven't played.
Yeah, that game has a lot of personality. It's kind of a mixture between that Wind Waker style and more of like a Twilight Princess kind of realistic dark style. I just don't like the darkness. All the fluffy stuff.
There's plenty of other games where you can get that. There's no reason for the Zelda game to be super dark. I mean, yeah, maybe a couple choice moments around, like, you know, the villains or whatever, but beyond that, I mean, no reason to be, like, you know.
Even though the game at the top of my list was extremely dark, but the thing that I like about Majora's Mask,
<That's true.
laughs> going back to that, the thing that I like about Majora's Mask is there's, like, this lightheartedness about it that's just surrounded by darkness. Like, the main enemy in the game is just, like, a kid that was bullied and, you know, was lonely, whatever, that has this evil mask taking control of him. Mm. So the whole game just kind of feels like that, and when you defeat the mask, then it's just like,
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
So,
man, so that was it then. That's all of them.
Yeah, I think that's all.
That was an extremely long segment.
Yeah, I'm glad we didn't decide to talk about the other thing we were going to talk about.
Oh, I know. Next time, but I have a feeling that the top tier segment's probably going to be the majority of our episodes going forward.
Yep. Yep. Yep.
Lots of things to talk about. So, awesome. Is there anything else that you wanted to discuss before we call it a podcast?
I do not think so, other than all the peoples need to follow us on all the things. On the Twitter.
Before that, I have a segment that I want to introduce, and I don't know if this is a real thing. I'm just going to call it a segment because I want to be kitschy. Jordan's Disappointment Corner. I probably got millions of years of material for this, but I'm going to pick one thing in particular, and I'm not going to speak about it very long. I may speak about this in length at a future date, but so I recently purchased during the Steam summer sale Outlast for the PC, because, you know, I'd read places that, oh, it's a great game, it's scary, this, that, and the other, it's a great horror game. And I haven't played it. I still have not played it. But I did watch the React channels play, like teens react to playing it. And I have to say that unless it was edited in some way that made it seem less scary, I was really disappointed with what that game looks like. Like, I thought that, you know, it was going to be nobody. It was just you in this insane asylum by yourself the whole time. In complete darkness, like never any light, and all you had was the camera, and that's not what it is at all, like at all. That was extremely disappointing to me, and I don't even know that I care to play it now, especially seeing how it ends and whatnot.
Yeah, I got it for free. It was a PlayStation Plus game. I probably played it for like 30, 45 minutes or something like that. Pissed myself and turned it off.
Yeah, I mean, it's a bunch of jump scares, and I definitely would imagine that I would jump.
The most entertaining thing about that game is Markiplier's reaction video. Just him.
Oh, man.
It's just, you know, like a 3-minute video of him screaming at all the different jump scares in the game.
I have to go watch that. Oh, man.
Look that up. It's very amusing.
That's awesome. Oh, man. I hadn't seen him doing that. I have been watching a lot of Markiplier lately, though.
Yes.
That dude's got a sexy voice, if I may say so.
Yes, he does. I probably watch more YouTube now than I do anything, honestly. Yeah. I've subscribed to a bunch of people that, you know, I really dig the content that they put out and support them and whatever. And
so we can plug those guys right now. Markiplier, Game Grumps, Alpha Omega Sin. That's a guy I like. I don't know if you watch him at all. Yeah. Trying to think who else.
Game Chasers.
Oh yeah, those guys are great.
Retro Liberty. I don't know if you've watched any of them.
I did. I did start watching some of their stuff recently. That's some good stuff. Cinemasker, of course.
Yes. Yes. No. I mean, that's just a given. Is what that is. Metal Jesus. Have you watched any of his stuff?
No.
He is very, very informative. Yeah, he does. He just
awesome.
He has a huge collection, just plays kind of everything, talks about everything.
Sweet. I'll have to check him out.
GameSack is another good one for informative things.
I need to start writing this down myself.
Yeah.
Taking notes. Continue.
Yes. Metal Jesus should be easy to remember. GameSack, yeah. What else? I don't have my YouTube stuff pulled up right now.
Yeah, I know. That's what I've been trying to.
If there's anything else I think I will just mention.
Oh, Jacksepticeye. If you like listening to people with accents, Jacksepticeye. He's pretty cool. So go check those people out on YouTube. If you're listening to us on SoundCloud, you can go to YouTube. If you're on YouTube, just type it in up there and hit the return key. And
yeah, man.
Away you go. Man, I said return key. That makes me old, right?
I think it does.
All right, so all those plugs aside, I think this has been a sufficiently lengthy podcast. What would say you, Mr. Hammer K?
I would agree with that statement. I'm probably not going to be able to edit it in Vegas again.
Uh-oh.
Freaking worthless application.
Oh, man. There's another topic for another time.
Anyway.
All right, so as the Hammer K himself was saying previously, follow us on all of the things. The Twiddlers, the YouTublers, the Facebooklers, the internets in general.
The internets.
There needs to be a website called theinternet.com. And theinternet.com/orderoftier should be our thing. Anyway, yes, videogamemetal.com. That's basically theinternet.com, videogamemetal.com. Yes. That's where you can listen to our music. You can download it for free if you so choose. Check us out. We will be back in a couple weeks with another episode of the podcast. Hopefully by then we'll get some things rolling on this cover we're going to do. And maybe
by the way.
Uh-oh, yes.
Oh, sorry.
No.
We are planning on releasing these podcasts every other Monday. So that's kind of what we're doing. We're going to record it. Hopefully the Monday before that, if something comes up, then we'll record it somewhere else during the week. But we'll try to tweet about it. And if any of you guys have anything you want us to talk about, any questions, whatever, let us know. And we would love to partake in said activities.
We need to make a hashtag for it.
Yes, we do.
I've already figured out what it is.
What is it?
Hashtag talk to tier.
Yeah. That's the name of the segment.
So
we're getting and cornier as the days go on.
That's the point of life, I think.
Exactly.
So, alright. everybody, follow us on all the things. Thank you so much for sticking with us for so long and listening, and we will see you guys again next time. I am Jordan B. Sanders. That guy is Mike the Hammer K. Kludzinski, and we are Order of Tear. You guys take care. We'll see you next time. Later. Yes.
Deuces.